Recorded Books and RB Digital present Open Carry by Marc Cameron. Narrated by David Chandler. Prologue. Prince of Wales Island, Alaska. The maze of deadfall was higher than her head, as if God had walked away from a massive game of pickup sticks. In the darkness behind her were the sounds of a predator. Boots shuffled on dusty ground, stopped abruptly, and then moved closer. Millie pictured the cloud of vapor around a nose, sniffing the chilly air. Her rubber boots made little noise on the carpet of decaying spruce needles. It didn't matter. The scent of fear was enough to give her away. A branch snapped somewhere in the shadows, flushing the girl from her hide like a panicked grouse. Floundering over snot-slick moss and through thorny stalks of devil's club, she fell more than she ran. She thrust herself forward somewhere between a frantic scramble and a scuttling crawl. Blood oozed from gashes on her streaked face, dripping off her chin and onto her t-shirt. Her knees and palms were raw and ravaged. Few of the logs made passable bridges over the rubble, pathways to gain precious ground toward her skiff. Most crumbled at her touch, rotten and soggy, sending her clamoring for a foothold before she impaled herself. Millie Burkett was Tlingit, people of the tides and forest, and these giant trees had been her friends for all of her 16 years. Their groans and snaps were normal, and their mottled shadows a perfect place to hide. Her earliest memories were of playing at the mossy feet of the great trees as they watched over her like a kindly grandmother. But now, the Sitka spruce, western hemlock, and yellow cedar loomed like hateful villains from a movie. An eerie silence pervaded the forest. Rain clouds pressed through the dense canopy, adding a sinister air that chased away the light. Wheezing and winded, Millie ducked around a massive spruce at least 8 feet across. She yanked a curtain of black hair away from her face and pressed her back against the rough bark. Straining to hear over the thump of her runaway heart, she listened to the sounds of the forest, like her mother had taught her. A branch cracked in the cathedral-like stillness. Doubling her efforts, Millie crashed through a wicked tangle of leaves and ropey stalks twice her height, oblivious to the scourging. Her camera swung back and forth from a strap around her neck, snagging on the vegetation and threatening to hang her. A spruce hen exploded with a drumbeat of wings to her right. She cut left into a jagged, half-rotten limb as big as her wrist that slashed at her belly. Startled, she tried to jump again, but the gnarled branch seemed to reach out and grab her, clawing at the loose tail of her wool shirt, tearing away a strip of plaid cloth and nearly upending her. She knew these forests. Her people had called them home for thousands of years. The stony silence of bear, the chiding of squirrel, or the drumming whoosh of raven's wings. They were to her as the patter of falling rain or the lapping of ocean tides. But today was different. She should have known better than to come alone. Tucker had warned her. He ventured out alone all the time with his camera, but he was at least 10 years older, probably more, and he knew the risks. She choked back a sob. If only she'd listened. Head spinning with fear and fatigue, she ducked under, over, and around the towering, tilted trees, many of them 2 or 3 meters wide. It was still light enough to pick her way through, but dark enough that there were no shadows. Millie's lungs felt ready to explode by the time the giant spruces began to give way to thicker undergrowth. There was more light here and a spit of rain. The odor of rotting bull kelp and low tide swirled on the breeze, filling her with a sudden rush of hope. Her skiff came into view as she ran, at the edge of the water less than 200 yards below. If she could just make it to the boat, she might have a chance. Long legs and freewheel down the steep incline, the Tlingit girl was sure she was beating her best cross-country record. Her heart sank when she saw the tide was out. It left the bow of her aluminum skiff on the gravel slope, but the stern still bobbed in the shallows, and the shore fell away quickly into deep water. She prayed her little outboard would be able to pull her off the rocks. Air chambers in the carpet of bladder kelp popped and snapped beneath the soles of her boots as she hit the tide line. She fell twice between the line of driftwood flotsam and the edge of the water. Broken shells and barnacle-covered rocks tore her shredded knees and hands, but she didn't care. Sliding to a stop on the slick rocks, she pulled the anchor line off the large stone where she'd looped it and clambered over the side of the little aluminum boat. Her back to the shore, she sat on an overturned 5-gallon bucket that made up her seat and worked to coax the reluctant outboard to life. She pumped the bulb on the gas line, opened the choke, then put her back into the starter rope. The 30-horse Tohatsu coughed on the first two pulls, as it always did, and she didn't hear the crunch of gravel behind her until it was almost on top of her. Millie Burkett turned to see a face she knew well, smiling at her. One hand still on the starter rope, her eyes shot to the dark woods above the beach. "What are you doing here?" Unwilling to take the time to explain the gravity of their situation, she turned back to the motor to give it another pull. "Never mind," she said. "Just get in. We have to..." Something heavy struck the back of her skull, knocking her off the bucket. Reeling, she flailed out with both hands, trying to catch herself, grasping nothing but air. A second blow, more powerful than the first, drove her to her knees. A shower of lights exploded behind her eyes. Molten blades inside her brain spun with sickening regularity, pulsing with each beat of her heart. She pitched forward, against the cold deck, vaguely aware of splintered wood and the copper taste of blood. The fleeting image of a rubber boot passed inches from her face, and the heavy ache in her skull dragged her into blackness. The terrifying realization that she'd been stuffed in some kind of sack hit her all at once. Panicking, she jerked from side to side, finally realizing that only by moving her face away from the rough cloth could she get any air. Her hands were bound in front of her, low at her waist. The rough cloth was there as well, against her hips. The thump of lapping water on an aluminum hull told her she was on the floor of a boat. Nauseated, she pulled her knees to her chest, trying to keep the world around her from spinning out of control. She wanted to scream, but managed little more than a pathetic whimper. The effort was just too painful. The back of her head felt as if it had been opened with an axe. She remembered that there was someone else at the boat when she'd been attacked, a person she knew, but the face escaped her. The boat rocked heavily to one side, and someone grabbed her feet, hauling them up on the metal gunwale. Good. They were getting out. A disembodied voice muttered something she couldn't understand. The boat rocked again as her body was hauled roughly upward. She strained to recall the face. "Where are you taking me?" Her father had told her stories about what happened to young girls who were kidnapped. "Please?" Her chest was racked with sobs. I don't know anything. Please, just let me go." Now sitting on the edge of the boat, Millie heard a splash behind her. A line zipped over the aluminum gunwale, filling her with deadly dread. An anchor. An instant later, the rope went taut, yanking hard at her ankles and dragging her off the edge of the boat. She sucked in a final, desperate breath before she went under, but shock from entering the frigid water drove much of the wind from her lungs. Intense pressure pushed at her eardrums as the anchor pulled her down. Millie Burkett screamed away her last breath as the anchor slammed into the muddy bottom. She remembered, and the name of her killer rose toward the surface on a stream of silver-green bubbles. Viam invaniam aut faciam. I shall find a way, or make one. Chapter 1. Supervisory Deputy U.S. Marshal Arliss Cutter knew how to smile, but it took effort and often came at great expense. More than once, the flash of his killer dimples had sent him crashing headlong into an ill-advised and short-lived marriage. The dimples were a genetic gift from his mother, but he'd also inherited the resting, mean mug of his paternal grandfather, whom everyone called Grumpy. The mean mug turned out to be perfectly suited to a man who hunted other men for a living. Cutter stood beside his government-issue Ford Escape, the irony of the name not eluding him as a manhunter. The hood of the small white SUV was surrounded by the seven other members of his ad hoc arrest team, each of them dressed in the full battle rattle of law enforcement on a mission. The three Anchorage PD officers looked bedraggled, having spent the last 6 hours of a 10-hour shift shagging back-to-back calls for service. One had a mud stain on the thigh of his dark blue uniform, like he'd slid into home plate. Anchorage could get rough after midnight. The two special agents from the DEA, along with the two deputy U.S. Marshals assigned to the Alaska Fugitive Task Force, had the damp hair and scrubbed pink look of people who'd showered and rushed out the door in order to make it to the 5 a.m. briefing. One of the DEA guys still had a bit of tissue paper stuck to a shaving cut on his neck. These two sported neatly trimmed, matching goatees, though one had more salt and pepper than the other. Counting his time in the Army, Cutter had almost 20 years of experience tracking evil men, but this position with the Fugitive Task Force was new. He was a hands-on leader, and would be hands-on during this first op in Alaska. The chilly breeze teased at his sandy hair, pushing a Superman curl across his forehead. He took a deep breath, drawing in the spring smells of flowering birch sap and new spruce growth. He was a long way from his home state of Florida and its comforting familiarity. There was a real upside to working fugitive cases in the last frontier, at least during the spring and summer. The hours of darkness were few and far between now, so the bandits spent most of their time running around like cockroaches trying to find a place to hide. In Cutter's experience, stomping roaches was easy when they ventured into the light. There had been plenty of cockroaches in Florida, and it turned out there were a few in Alaska that needed a boot heel as well. The roach of the moment, Frederick Donut Woodfield, had a criminal history that said he'd gone peacefully during each of his 17 previous arrests. There was no reason to believe that today would be any different. Cutter checked the bug, or backup gun, in any case. It was a small Glock he wore in a holster over his right kidney. On his hip, He carried a stainless steel Colt Python revolver with the Florida Department of Law Enforcement badge engraved over the action. Arliss Cutter was fresh to the District of Alaska, and as such, the two deputies assigned to his task force were fresh to him. All three were still in what Grumpy Cutter had called the butt-sniffing stage. They were untested, getting to know each other's ways, the good, the bad, and the stuff that might get somebody killed. The deputies had yet to see Cutter lead, and he'd not seen either of them in a fight. That, too, was apt to change. The pursuit of violent fugitives virtually guaranteed it. Deputy U.S. Marshal Sean Blodgett stood to Cutter's immediate right. Bull strong, but 30 pounds on the heavy side, Blodgett's thick forearms rested T-Rex-like on the magazine pouches and personal trauma kit on the front of an OD green armored plate carrier he wore over a tight navy blue T-shirt. A subdued green and black Circle Star badge was affixed over his left breast. A short-barreled Colt M4 carbine hung vertically from a single-point sling around the deputy's neck. Bold letters on the back of the vest said, "Police, U.S. Marshal." At 26, Deputy Lola Fontaine was what Cutter's grandfather would have called a healthy girl. Naturally thick across her hips and shoulders from her Polynesian roots, she took her fitness to the extreme. Decked out in the early morning light, she reminded Cutter of something from an advertisement for tactical gear. Similar to Deputy Blodgett's, her vest identified her as a U.S. Marshal. But her intense countenance and chiseled arms screamed, "Badass." She kept her dark hair pulled back in a tight bun that highlighted her wide cheekbones and made her look more mature than she actually was. Chestnut eyes issued a challenge to anyone who met them for too long. She was around 5.5 feet tall, but Cutter didn't have to guess her weight because she kept a record of it on a piece of printer paper taped to her computer. Yesterday she'd scrawled 134 pounds of blue twisted steel. She had proclaimed this her fighting weight, and no one in the task force offices argued with her. Cutter had heard her tell war stories in the squad room about the fights she'd been involved in, and considering the swagger with which she walked through life, he was inclined to believe her. Boiled down to its core, manhunting was a straightforward science. Deputy U.S. Marshals cared little for the what, when, or why of a crime, but focused with a laser-like intensity on who and where. In theory, now that they had a location on Donut Woodfield, it was a simple matter of closing in and scooping him up. But in practice, few theories survived first contact with a fugitive. Cutter glanced at the two seasoned agents from the United States Drug Enforcement Administration, Sims and Bradley. Each was dressed in a thin blue raid jacket pulled over an olive drab tactical vest. Each topped off their extra ammo, personal trauma kits, and other tactical gear with two flashbang grenades. A little over the top for someone not in a SWAT unit, but it was hard to argue against taking extra gear as long as it didn't weigh you down. The DEA guys appeared to be capable enough, though Sims, the younger of the two agents, made a lame joke that Lola Fontaine was a stripper's name. Cutter did what any good supervisor would do. He quietly led the man away from the group and threatened to kick his ass if he heard that kind of talk about one of his people again. Although it took a few minutes away from the gathering, it was time well spent. With a 6'3", 240-pound supervisory deputy making sure he watched his P's and Q's, Special Agent Sims became a picture of decorum. Deputy Blodgett had also made fun of Lola Fontaine's stripper-esque name. but in private and as part of the USMS family. So Cutter had let it slide with nothing more than a raised eyebrow. Even that had the same effect. As per their standard operating procedure on a raid, both DEA agents wore black balaclavas, ready to roll down over their goateed faces just prior to booting the door. The other five members of the team, the three uniformed APD officers and the two deputy marshals, were young, pitifully so in Cutter's mind, young enough to make his 42-year-old bones ache. He was at least a decade older than anyone else there. But young didn't necessarily mean inexperienced, especially for the coppers. Serving a population of 300,000, these APD officers witnessed enough human conflict and unmitigated stupidity every night to mature them at near lightning speed. Out of habit, Cutter touched the small leather bag tucked into his belt, and then leaned over his Ford to get one last good look at the floor plan drawn there in erasable marker, a mobile whiteboard. It was just before 5:30 in the morning, but the other members of the team cast dark shadows across the hood. He was satisfied that he had a solid mental picture of the apartment complex they were about to hit, but as supervisory deputy, Cutter positioned himself to face the rising sun, making certain everyone else could study the diagram before they went in. He'd seen too many good people die over some piddling mistake, and wasn't about to let it happen on his watch. The oldest of the APD officers, a sergeant named Evers, was likely in his early 30s. He shot a glance at the sad little set of apartments set among the white birch trees in the quiet neighborhood off Spinard Road, then looked back at the diagram drawn on the hood. "Anybody been inside this place before?" "I have," one of the APD officers said, raising a black-gloved hand. "It's basically four floors of horrors, Sarge." He looked as though he might still be in middle school, but spoke with the conviction of a man 10 years his senior, and this calmed Cutter a notch. "The landlord lives in California," Deputy Blodgett added. "He's got a rap sheet as long as your arm for heroin distribution and use. I'm not even sure if he remembers he owns the damn thing." Lola Fontaine shoved a powder-blue warrant folder across the hood toward the APD officers. It was thick with Woodfield's background information and known associates. She'd folded it open to the criminal history page. "Frederick James Woodfield," she said, tapping the photograph with the bright red nail of her index finger. "A.K.A. Donut." "That's a fit dude for a heroin dealer," Sergeant Evers said. "Doesn't look like someone named Donut." Fontaine shrugged, wincing a little from the movement. Even in the chill, she was still sweating from her 4 a.m. pre-raid workout, and her arms glistened in the morning light. Both of the younger APD officers were mesmerized by her. It would have made Cutter smile, if he were the smiling sort. "Whew!" she gasped, half under her breath. "It was shoulder day this morning, and I am feeling it." She glanced up at Blodgett. "I could barely get into my T-shirt at the gym. Know what I'm saying?" Cutter cleared his throat, keeping her on task. "Donut?" "Right," she said, rolling her shoulders again. "Not sure why, but that's what everybody calls him. He's got warrants out of California, Washington, and Alaska for distribution. Black male, 6'5", 260 pounds. He's got ties to the TMHG, Too Many Hoes Gang, one of the Crips affiliates out of L.A. Maybe the name comes from them." The APD officer nearest Cutter dragged his eyes off Fontaine's biceps long enough to study the photograph of their target and whistled under his breath. Officer Trent, a callow string bean who looked fresh out of the academy, tapped the line that showed Woodfield's date of birth and shook his head. 28? Isn't that ancient for a guy in a street gang?" "True," Cutter said. So our guy's on the fourth floor? Sergeant Evers repeated back information he'd already been given. Cutter didn't blame him. Cops were more terrified of hitting the wrong place than they were of flying bullets. Cutter looked at Deputy Fontaine, letting her answer. It was a DEA warrant, but they turned it over to the Marshal Service. Cutter wanted to make sure everyone here knew this operation was Fontaine's show. Correct, the deputy said. Apartment 405, three down after we topped the stairs on the south side of the hall. Evers nodded. I'd still be happy to bring in SWAT, he said. If you think this guy's going to barricade. That's your call, Cutter replied to the sergeant, taking a half step back and crossing his arms. If it would ease your mind, this is your city. Cutter knew that being able to personally slap the cuffs on a fugitive at the end of a long hunt was a point of pride with those who hunted men. He wasn't immune to the notion, but if there was any indication that Donut Woodfield was going to be a problem, he would have stepped in and called SWAT himself. All the men looked at Lola Fontaine. The two DEA agents shuffled a bit, and everyone seemed to be holding their breath at this critical juncture. The whole operational plan could change with her next words. Fontaine flashed a quick look at Blodgett, then confidently shook her head and pointed to the criminal history. He's never put up any fight before. I think we're good with what we got. She flashed a grin at the APD officers. Cutter couldn't help but notice that even her face had clearly sculpted muscles. I appreciate you guys coming along, though. A uniform presence keeps the neighbors from going apeshit. And anyhow, Deputy Blodgett chimed in, we got a pile of five more of these mooks around Anchorage that we're going to hit today. SWAT's got no time for that. Blodgett was from Nevada, but used words like mook and perp as if he'd grown up as an NYPD beat cop. Evers gave a low groan, still mulling it over. He's supposed to be alone? Fontaine gave a noncommittal shrug. That's what we understand, she said. Okay. The sergeant stepped back from the Ford. We seven rock stars should be able to handle it. Are you planning to knock and announce first? He glanced down at the breaching ram resting upright on the pavement at Blodgett's feet. 50 pounds of steel and painted flat black, it resembled a length of railroad track with two hoop handles and a flat plate welded to the end, because that's exactly what it was. The older DEA agent coughed, drawing attention in his direction. There is a good chance this guy's holding a fistful of black tar heroin. If it's all the same to you, we'd like to get inside before he has a chance to run it down the garbage disposal. Daisy will make that happen for us, Blodgett smiled and gave the ram an affectionate pat. The sergeant studied his two officers, looking them up and down the way good field leaders do to make sure their people are squared away. Satisfied, he turned back to Cutter. No fire escape on that end of the building. We can all go to the front door. You guys will handle the breaching tool, right? If my guys touch it, I gotta call SWAT. Blodgett hoisted the steel ram to his chest. Nobody's touching Daisy but me, he said. Special Agent Sims threw a black nylon backpack over his vest. It held a pair of bolt cutters and a hooked breaching bar that resembled a hammer with one claw called a Halligan tool. It would be invaluable in the event Donut's door happened to open outward or was too flimsy to make Daisy effective. Here we go, then, Evers said, waving toward Donut Woodfield's four floors of whores. We'll follow you. Lola Fontaine led the convoy of six law enforcement vehicles off Spinard Road, parking behind the cover of the birch trees on the north side of the building, away from Donut's apartment. With no reason to dally, the team eased their vehicle doors shut, then moved immediately into the main entrance of the apartments. They stacked in the same order they would hit the door. Fontaine was in the lead, Deputy Blodgett behind her with the ram, followed by Cutter, the two DEA agents, and APD acting as overwatch in the rear. The overwhelming stench of trash and dirty socks hit Cutter full in the face. Deputy Blodgett took a deep breath through his nose as if savoring a favorite meal. "Mmm," he whispered. "Yummy." The building had an elevator, but the team opted for the stairs, moving at a fast trot. They stayed close enough to reach out and touch, but just far enough apart so as not to bump into one another. Her Glock drawn and pointed at the floor. Fontaine indicated 405 with her free hand, confirming that was the apartment as soon as they reached it. Cutter had warned her about spending too much time on target. Rather than ramming the door immediately, she reached to gingerly try the knob. It wasn't the worst thing in the world to ram an unlocked door, but it was as embarrassing as hell. It was locked. Fontaine gave a whispered hiss. "Breach her up!" She stepped to the side, allowing Blodgett room to swing the heavy ram. She would take the lead inside once the door gave way, while everyone else filed in behind her. Blodgett, having dropped the ram and transitioned to his rifle, would follow at the rear of the stack. The door was metal with a solid core, and from the looks of it, had a deep, reinforced deadbolt. There was a peephole at eye level, so Cutter gave a thumbs up, ordering them to make entry. Blodgett took a stance and swung Daisy back at the same time Cutter saw a camera mounted on the ceiling in the far corner of the hallway. He noticed it a fraction of a second too late. The heavy door swung open an instant before the steel ram made contact, causing Blodgett to lose his balance and stumble forward. A dark and brawny arm grabbed the deputy and yanked him inside before slamming the door. The deadbolt slid home with a definitive clunk, leaving Cutter and the rest of his team standing flat-footed in the hallway with no ram. Chapter 2. Arliss Cutter put his boot to the door, getting nothing but a sickeningly solid thud. With the breaching ram and Blodgett in the apartment, Cutter and the rest of the team were effectively locked out. "What the hell just happened?" one of the DEA agents gasped. They looked up and down the hall in disbelief, guns still drawn, at the ready, one man gone and no bad guy in sight. It sounded like two elephants battling it out on the other side of the door. Dust streamed down from the ceiling as something heavy shook the wall. Cutter looked up and saw the hallway had a suspended ceiling and motioned Fontaine over with a quick flick of his wrist. Keeping clear of the door in the event Donut decided to start shooting, he holstered his Colt and interlaced his fingers, stooping to give her a place to stand. "I'm going to lift you up," he said. "Let me know what you see." Instantly, she grabbed his shoulders and stepped into his hands, pushing the acoustic tile out of the way as Cutter stood. "No good," she said when he lowered her back down. "Walls go all the way up to the next floor." Muffled screams carried through the walls, along with the sound of heavy pounding. Someone was being beaten to death. Sergeant Evers tried to boot the door again. It did little but scuff the metal facing. Next, both APD officers set to kicking the door together. Soon everyone was taking turns with zero results. The sergeant got on his radio and called for backup, but Cutter knew it would be too little too late. This would all be over before anyone could arrive with another ram. Inside Woodfield's apartment, it was all-out war. Glass shattered. Furniture crunched as the men engaged in an epic knockdown drag-out brawl. Donut Woodfield had 6 inches and 60 pounds on Blodgett. Even if the bandit wasn't armed, Cutter knew there were at least two guns inside. Blodgett's. The deputy was loud and brash, and thankfully he was built like a small Sherman tank. Cutter just hoped he knew how to fight. Cutter drew his pistol again and snapped his fingers at the DEA agents. "Use the Halligan," he said. Sims moved up immediately, drawing the metal tool from his shoulder bag like a sword. He tried to pry the door next to the deadbolt, but it held firm. "It's reinforced," the DEA agent said through a clenched jaw. He moved the flat edge up and down the jamb, beating it against the metal to try and find a sweet spot. Cutter's heart raced as he listened to the clatter on the other side of the door. "This is really stuffed," Fontaine whispered, looking much less muscular than she had just moments before. "He's killing Sean in there." Helpless, Cutter cast his eyes up and down the hallway, hoping to find a fire axe or something with which to make entry and save his deputy. Sean Blodgett had been on his own a full minute, an eternity when you're fighting for your life. Cutter tried not to imagine the scene, focusing instead on a way inside. The door to 407 opened a crack, and a dark eye peered out. The door started to close, but Cutter shoved his foot inside, forcing it open to reveal a bony-kneed brunette with track marks on her arms. She wore a thin T-shirt and loose gym shorts, the easy-on, easy-off uniform of a hooker who worked from home. "Hey," she said, glancing backward at the marijuana plants growing by the balcony door. "You can't come in here without a warrant." "I don't care about your weed," Cutter said, working hard to keep his breathing under control so he could think. "You know your neighbor?" The battle in the next room was even louder from inside the hooker's apartment.
"He keeps to himself," the woman said.
She folded her arms and cocked a bony hip to one side. Agent Sims stuck his head in from the hallway, the muscles in his jaw clenched with stress.
"Halligan tool's not working for shit," he said. "I can't get through."
A series of ragged grunts came through from Donut's side of the wall. Cutter couldn't tell who made them, but at least there were no shots, and the tell-tale banging continued unabated. Cutter's eyes fell on the two flashbangs on the front of his vest before the DEA agent disappeared back into the hallway. An internal clock had started a countdown the moment the door had slammed shut behind Sean Blodgett, with something telling Cutter that if he could get through the door within 3 minutes, he might have a chance to save his deputy. He glanced at his watch. 2 minutes gone.
"Bring me the Halligan," Cutter snapped.
Sims stared.
"You want it in here?"
"Just bring it," Cutter snapped. "Fast."
Deputy Fontaine ducked in behind Agent Sims, sweat plastered strands of dark hair to her forehead from her continued efforts to break down the door. Panting, she gave Cutter a quizzical look.
"Did you find another way in?"
"Maybe." Cutter snatched the metal bar from the DEA agent. "Maybe not."
Using the wingspan of his arms, he measured approximately 5 feet from the door inside the woman's apartment, then buried the pick-like spike on the end of the Halligan tool in the sheetrock. The building was decades old, and it was easy to see the swell of the wooden studs in the adjoining sheetrock wall. He punched 2 holes, 6 inches apart, and at chest level between the swells.
"Hey!"
The hooker tried to step forward, but Fontaine checked her with a hip.
"But this is my house!"
Cutter ignored her. He yanked open the Velcro closure of his ballistic vest and slid the entire thing up and over his head, dropping it on the floor. He turned immediately to the DEA agent and held out an open hand.
"Give me one of the flashbangs. You take the other one. Pull the pin and drop it into the wall the same time I do."
Sims nodded, looking like he understood the plan.
"This might actually work," he said,
dropping his stun grenade into the hollow of the wall in unison with Cutter. 2 seconds later, dust shot from each hole with a muffled whoomph. Confined to the bottom of the hollow wall, the relatively small explosion still produced enough force to peel the sheetrock away from the studs, giving Cutter just enough space to insert the Halligan tool. He ripped upward, frantically tearing away the sheetrock on his side and exposing Woodfield's inner wall. The studs were set a full 2 feet apart, but even without his vest, the remaining gear forced Cutter to turn sideways in order to fit. Heavy bar in hand, he slipped between the studs, sucking in his gut to avoid rusty nails and ancient wiring. Putting a shoulder to the opposing wall, he crashed through the sheetrock wall, nearly falling over the tangled knot that was deputy and donut. Not a stick of furniture in the apartment remained upright. Shattered glass and broken picture frames littered the carpet. A pan of what looked like half-eaten lasagna lay overturned in the middle of the living room floor. Sean Blodgett was on his back, his Glock apparently having been dislodged from the holster. The rifle was nowhere to be seen. Woodfield stood above him with a broken baseball bat high overhead, raining down blows in an effort to brain the deputy. Legs up, Blodgett shielded his face with his forearms and rolled back and forth to avoid the bat. Blood sprayed from Woodfield's nose with each breath. His jaw hung at an odd angle. Blodgett's left eye was swollen shut. Blood dripped from his elbows. Cutter roared, enraged at seeing his deputy on the receiving end of the beating. Plowing into the startled donut Woodfield, he knocked the man off his feet and gave Blodgett a few seconds to regroup. Wounded, but far from finished, Donut rolled and spun to face the new threat. Cutter lunged forward, oblivious to the bat, swinging the Halligan like a polo mallet. He buried the spike end of the tool in Donut's shoulder as he went past. The fugitive jerked away, shrugging off the wound and raising the bat again. Enraged and intent on braining the fugitive, Cutter rushed him a third time, narrowly missing his head with the Halligan tool, but catching the bandit in the right hand as he tried to ward off the blow. The outlaw screamed in pain. Cutter used the spike as a hook and yanked Donut into a left cross that landed on his already shattered jaw. Woodfield dropped the bat and collapsed screaming to the floor. Momentum from the punch sent Cutter stepping past. Fontaine had come through the wall right behind Cutter and jumped on top of the dazed fugitive before Cutter could turn around. Blodgett crawled up beside her, squinting with his good eye while he helped pin one of Woodfield's arms so she could ratchet on the handcuffs. Nostrils flaring, Cutter came at all of them with a raised Halligan tool. Fontaine held up her hand to ward him off. "We've got him!" "What?" Cutter said, blinking, still brandishing the heavy steel bar.
"Arliss!" Fontaine snapped. "It's me, Lola! We're good here. He's cuffed."
Lola Fontaine stared up at her new boss as he held the Halligan tool high above his head, eyeing Donut Woodfield like a piece of meat. A lock of her long hair had worked its way loose from the bun, and she blew it out of her face so she wouldn't lose eye contact with Cutter. At length, he let the metal bar clatter to the floor and shook his head as if to clear it. Stepping to the door, he flipped the latch to allow the rest of the team inside the demolished apartment. Fontaine rolled the now subdued Donut onto his side, patting him down for weapons. She steered clear of his blood-soaked shoulder, but he winced wherever she happened to touch him. Sean had done some damage, and it was clear Cutter had broken a bone or two with the iron bar.
"Did you see that?"
she whispered so the thug couldn't hear. Blodgett chuckled, filled with the euphoria of still being alive. "I can't see shit," he said, squinting at her, a curtain of blood over his face.
"I thought this new supervisor was the picture of calm," she said. but I'm pretty sure he was about to bury the spike end of that crowbar into this guy's face.
I told you, Blodgett said, still keeping his voice low. The new guy's got issues. My friends at headquarters say he did some pretty bad shit in Afghanistan.
Saw bad shit? Or did bad shit?
Blodgett got on all fours and used an overturned chair to push himself to his feet. From what I hear, a hell of a lot of both.
Chapter 3. 29 was much too young for Carmen Delgado to contemplate her own death. But gazing out at the cold sea with the frost-covered graves behind her, she could think of little else. The island was beautiful, pristine even, with green mountains, old-growth forests, and more waterfalls per mile than any place she'd ever seen. And still, it was impossible to shake the feeling that this place was going to kill her. She'd never seen a more cinematic location. Even now, three fishing boats chugged out in front of her, braving the slap of a cold morning wind to bring back a haul of kelp for the herring roe fishery. Carmen had heard the old, "Odds were good, but the goods were odd," saw in regards to the male-to-female ratio in Alaska so many times it wasn't funny. If a girl was into flannel-wearing hipster guys with well-oiled beards and ear gauges, who could make the finest caramel macchiato on the planet but didn't know one end of a chainsaw from the other, that was probably true. But so far as Carmen could see, the fishermen and loggers on this island were some of the toughest, most resilient men on Earth, which made what she was doing to them even more difficult to stomach. Hugging her knees to her chest, Carmen pulled her head deeper into her fleece, nibbling on the collar as she often did when she was nervous or thinking. To her left, across the breakwater bridge and up past the boat harbor, the quaint little town of Craig lay nestled alongside a place called Shelter Cove. She couldn't have come up with a better name if the network had sent in a script change. There were wolves on the island, and bears too, burly black things that were three times her size. A fisherman at J.T. Brown's general store tried to calm her fears by reminding her that wolves only ate short people, a small comfort to someone a hair over 5 feet tall. The same well-meaning guy had gone on to explain that she didn't have to worry about any grizzlies on the island, only the much more timid black bears. As an afterthought, he'd warned her that although black bears were more shy, if one did decide to approach, it was because they considered you to be food. Black bears had killed 2 people in Alaska the year before, but hey, you got nothing to worry about, kid. A Tlingit girl waiting in line at the same general store of horrors began to talk about native legends of fearsome frogs and shapeshifters who abducted women and forced them into mixed marriages with fanged otter men. Carmen had felt out of place from the moment she'd stepped off the ferry on her first scouting trip months before. She was a city girl, born and raised in East L.A. 2 of her cousins had been killed in shootouts with rival gang members, and a third was turning tricks on Atlantic Avenue. Nothing should have fazed her, not wolves or bears or creepy otter dudes, but they did. And what was worse, she had no one to blame for being here but herself. She'd spent the first 7 years after graduating from UCLA Film School clawing her way through menial crew jobs on several reality television productions, all the while filling stacks of spiral notebooks with her own ideas. None of them clicked. And then she'd watched a show on Nat Geo about life in the far north. It was an absolutely terrific program, chock-a-block full of interesting characters who not only lived but thrived in the harsh and unforgiving environment. The concept was as incredible as the location, and she began to watch everything she could get her hands on about Alaska. Carmen's brother was an LAPD cop, and she spent many evenings talking with her sister-in-law about the close friendships developed by cop spouses. One night while her brother was at work, she and her sister-in-law binged on pizza and watched a decades-old documentary about fishing in southeast Alaska. The kernel of an idea began to sprout in her mind. She worked through the night, filling up an entire notebook with a draft proposal for a smart new show, one that would inform and entertain. The production company she worked for funded a 3-week trip to Craig to shoot a sizzle reel. She returned to L.A. fairly giddy with the prospects. 2 weeks later, she was ready to pitch. A network picked up the show right off the bat, but, as par, had their own ideas. They read her treatment, watched her sizzle reel, and showered her with compliments on the fresh approach, then proceeded to change everything. Oh, they named her the executive producer, and in typical network fashion, said she was the one in charge. But she knew how it worked. Unless your title was signer of the checks, you weren't in charge of anything. In the span of 1 3-hour meeting with network execs, her baby became unrecognizable. Now she and the production crew of her gross monstrosity had descended on this picturesque little village in the middle of nowhere, and she feared the experience would change the place forever. There was something here that was likely to kill her all right, more deadly than any wolf or bear or otter man, and it wasn't indigenous to the island. No, whatever it was, this had come with her. Chapter 4. Deputy Blodgett needed to go to the hospital, so Cutter drove him. Fontaine and Special Agent Sims followed in her car with Donut Woodfield, who required an emergency room visit as well to get his various wounds treated before the jail would accept him. Blodgett completed his form CA-1 at the hospital, noting his on-the-job injuries in case they caused problems for him in the future. There was no real rush, but it would give him something to do while he waited. Cutter assured him he was good to go, despite what looked like a fractured orbital around his eye and a dislocated index finger that was probably broken. He was sure to feel much different once the adrenaline wore off. Donna Woodfield turned out to have a broken collarbone, 3 cracked ribs, and a dislocated jaw. The wounds in his shoulder and hand required 15 stitches combined. None of it was quite enough to keep him out of jail once he was treated. Cutter was pleased when it became clear that Woodfield was hurt worse than his deputy, but he kept that to himself. Special Agent Sims agreed to transport Blodgett home so Cutter could ride with Fontaine to the jail with the prisoner. He considered himself a you-catch-'em-you-clean-'em supervisor, and if he was in it for the fun of the arrest, he was also in it for the jail run and ensuing paperwork. The book-in took forever, with the jail nurse looking over her granny glasses at Woodfield, then the deputies, then the hospital paperwork, and then back to the deputies again. Lola Fontaine bounced with tension by the time she retrieved her handgun from the lockbox in the vehicle's sallyport and got back into Cutter's Ford. It was the first time they'd been out of earshot of the prisoner. The deputy snapped on her seatbelt and turned to look him in the eye. Her broad Polynesian face was passive, the kind of mysteriously all-knowing look that used to terrify Cutter when he saw it on his mother. "Is there anything you want to tell me, boss?"
"Nope," he said.
"You sure about that?" she asked. "Because I'm here to tell you. I think you're busting at the seams to talk to me."
You would be mistaken, Cutter said, putting the car in gear.
I only ask because things got pretty intense back there.
Let me ask you something, Lola, Cutter said. If you had seen Woodfield holding a bat over me, would you have shot him?
Fontaine shrugged. Many times, boss.
Well, there you go, Cutter said. Deadly force is deadly force. Shoot someone with a Glock or brain them with a metal bar, they're the same amount of dead.
Roger that, Fontaine said, still sounding unconvinced. She stared straight ahead, tapping the infernal pencil on her folder. At length she shrugged and sat back with a resigned sigh. I could use a workout. The Anchorage jail's sallyport was long and narrow, and Cutter had to drive forward 3 car lengths in order for the officers in the control center to notice him.
I was under the impression you worked out early this morning, he said. Shoulder day.
So?
Fontaine said, as if that was a supremely ignorant question.
My grandfather was a Cook Island Maori, and my grandmother was a robust girl from Nebraska who took up surfing to get off the farm. All my aunties on my father's side are big women, beautiful and strong, but a little too brawny to run very far, if you know what I mean. My mum's a skinny little thing of Japanese ancestry, but I take after my dad and his family. So I work out a lot.
She turned to stare at her side window, looking away from Cutter, and changed the subject.
You ever think about trying out for SOG?
SOG was the Special Operations Group, the U.S. Marshal Services answer to SWAT, or the FBI's Hostage Rescue Team. I have not, Cutter said. I'm a little long in the tooth to have a cadre of younger deputies scream at me for that entire month of SOG selection. Fontaine settled deeper into her seat. Her constant workouts and apparently clear conscience gave her the uncanny ability to drift off to sleep at a moment's notice. She leaned back and closed her eyes.
Because I've been thinking about putting in for SOG.
It was nearly 1 in the afternoon by the time Cutter swiped his proximity card and drove into the underground garage of the James M. Fitzgerald U.S. Courthouse and Federal Building in downtown Anchorage. He took the time to back his little Ford into his assigned spot near the prisoner garage, a habit that allowed for a quick egress. His hands were full of paperwork and the black ballistic nylon war bag where he kept his vest and other tactical gear when he wasn't actually wearing it. Lola was also laden down with gear from the raid. Thankfully, the court security officers in the control room noticed their approach on the garage cameras and buzzed open the door without either of them having to put anything down. The prisoner elevator was waiting with doors open by the time he and Lola made it through the steel door from the garage and into the man trap. It took them up a level to the outer corridors of the cell block and the back hallway of the U.S. Marshal's offices. A uniformed court security officer, or CSO, waited behind a window of bulletproof glass as they came off the elevator. Computers and CCTV camera monitors filled the dark room behind him. Cutter was still learning all the CSO's names, but he remembered this one as Bill. Like most of the CSOs, Bill was retired law enforcement, in this case a former Alaska State Trooper. He wore a white shirt with a red and blue striped clip-on tie. His work in the control room allowed him to leave the navy blue blazer draped over the back of his chair. On the other side of the glass, Bill's lips moved in time with the sounds crackling out of the intercom speaker on the wall. He looked directly at Lola Fontaine.
"Your husband's waiting for you out front by the admin desks," he said.
The disgusted eye roll was impossible to miss.
As powerful as she was, Fontaine's entire body drooped at the news. She'd been riding a high from the successful arrest, but this seemed to take all the sauce out of her. She took a deep breath as if to steel herself for what lay ahead. "Thanks, Bill." Cutter hadn't met the man, but even in his few weeks in the district, he'd learned it was common knowledge around the squad room that Larry Fontaine was a highly jealous man. According to the chief, the guy had convinced himself Lola was cheating on him while on a judicial protection assignment in Los Angeles and flew out to try and catch her in the act. Instead, he found her doing dumbbell lunges in the hotel gym. For some inexplicable reason, Lola stuck with the guy. Cutter couldn't help wonder how long that was going to last. There was no doubt she could have gotten someone with a few less hang-ups. Then again, Cutter didn't have room to talk. He'd been involved in his share of toxic relationships. His hands still full, Cutter shuddered at those memories and pushed open yet another heavy steel door with the toe of his boot. Escape-proof concrete block walls gave way to painted sheetrock, which was reinforced with metal grating, as they made their way down the final stretch of the secure hallway. Cutter's office was located with the rest of the fugitive task force on the other side of the federal building, away from the operational squad room and the USMS brass. Cutter had found this layout extremely appetizing when considering the move to the district. Never much of a garrison soldier, he was happiest when working as far from the flagpole as humanly possible. Normally, he would have gone straight to his office, but the chief had summoned him with a text, asking him to stop by and fill her in about the raid once they finished at the jail. Fontaine walked past, rounding the corner at the end of the hall by the administrative staff as Cutter stepped into the chief's office. He paused at the door. Jill Phillips sat pecking away at her computer, her extremely pregnant belly engaged in an ongoing fight with the lap tray that held her keyboard. Hailing from Kentucky, Phillips had one of the best reputations of anyone, boss or otherwise, in the United States Marshal Service. She had cut her teeth in the Judicial Security Division, running protective details for threatened members of the federal judiciary, including Supreme Court justices. Alaska was her first foray into the broader duties of management in a regular district office. She had been off for medical reasons for much of the time he'd been in district, but from what Cutter had seen, she was a natural, generally doing what a good boss should do, staying out of the way. Phillips pushed her chair back from her desk and rested both hands on the swell of her 7 months pregnant belly. Her brunette hair was cut short in a no-fuss professional bob that suited her slightly round and heavily freckled face.
"What's the news on Blodgett?"
"He'll mend," Cutter nodded. Donut Woodfield fractured his eye socket and broke his index finger. "His hands look like he beat them with a hammer, and he'll be on light duty for a while. But the bandit has it worse, though."
"Glad to hear that,"
Phillips said. Hands still on her belly, she studied Cutter.
"What's bugging you, Big Iron?"
Her eyes fell to the Colt Python on his hip. Every word was dipped in a honeyed Kentucky accent.
"We've not really had a chance to talk much since you got here. Remind me why I let you carry that super cool revolver when policy says I have to carry a Glock?"
Cutter turned sideways and displayed the small Glock 27 in a holster over his right kidney. "Don't know what you're talking about, Chief. My policy gun, my duty gun, is right here. The Colt Python is my backup."
"Still..."
"The Colt was my grandfather's," Cutter said. "He was with Florida Marine Patrol during my formative years. Got me interested in law enforcement."
"Fair enough," Phillips said. "Can't really argue with a tactical grandpa. But do me a favor and make sure you always have the Glock on you somewhere."
She waved at the two weathered lavender paisley side chairs and pulled out what was obviously his personnel file, flipping it open.
Roger that.
Cutter sat down, looking around the office. It was decorated with paintings of eventing horses and trophies from shooting contests she'd won. Photos of Phillips with Supreme Court justices and various law enforcement souvenirs also adorned the walls and covered an office-length credenza. Some believed the lavender chairs were the only feminine things in the office, but they were sorely mistaken. To Jill Phillips, doing anything like a girl meant doing it better than anyone else. Cutter sighed, eyeing the file on her desk.
I guess we should discuss the elephant in the room.
Phillips took a long breath.
All right, she said. You know, talking about my enormous belly that way is wildly inappropriate.
Cutter raised a hand, mouth open, starting to stammer. It would have had less of an effect if she'd thrown a brick at him.
You know I'm joking, Phillips scoffed. Seriously, though, what's up with you? I hardly know you, but I know flummoxed when I see it.
I'm fine, Cutter said, dropping his voice. I was just listening to Fontaine's husband down the hall.
The chief leaned forward, trying to listen.
What's he saying?
He's quizzing her about my 4 failed marriages. How does that stuff get around the district so fast?
The chief's desk squeaked as she arched her back, tapping a pen on the edge of her walnut desk.
Telephone, telegraph, and teledeputy, she said, still eyeing him. The way I understand it, one of your marriages didn't end in failure.
Depends on your point of view, Cutter said, wanting desperately to change the subject. 1 divorce and you can blame the ex. 3 and the guy I see in the mirror is the only common denominator.
Well, Phillips said, maybe you are just a jerk. Time will tell.
Cutter held up his hand again, craning his head toward the hallway, listening to Lola Fontaine's hushed voice and her husband, who was not nearly so muted. A smile spread across his face.
What? Phillips said. It looks weird when you do that.
Do what?
Smile, she said. I'm not used to it.
Cutter shook his head. Sounds like Lola's husband is about to come down here and kick my ass. Phillips gave Cutter a piercing look, like she was studying the back of his skull for clues. It would have been off-putting had she not been so genuine.
Are you sure you want her on the task force? Don't get me wrong, I like Lola, but she's got a tendency to be a bit of a blue flamer, if you ask me. I have requests on my desk for her to get a bomb dog, go to an armorer's school, attend interview training, and take part in a pursuit driving instructor's course in Vegas. On top of that, I have a package requesting consideration for promotion to the witness security division. Kids like a BB in a boxcar when it comes to applying for jobs.
There are worse qualities, Cutter said. She did tell me she's thinking about putting in for SOG.
Of course she is.
She handled herself like a champ today, he said.
Even so, Phillips said, her idiot husband could turn into a liability real fast.
She'll be fine. Cutter closed his eyes and sank further into the soft chair. I'm not worried about him.
I'm not either, Phillips said. I'm worried about you.
Cutter's eyes flicked open.
How's that?
He'd heard Jill Phillips was the kind of chief who didn't hold much back.
Don't take this the wrong way, she said. I think every good deputy has to have a little bit of hunter in the blood. But there's something harder about you. A berserk side, if that makes sense.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.